Good morning. Welcome to the First United Methodist Church here in downtown Erie. I'm Pastor Jim Parkinson. What we'd like to do is welcome all of you who are worshiping with us at home today. I know if some of you are actually worshiping together with some other family members, so if you would be so kind as to take a moment, go in the comment field if you have access to that. I know some people watching on TVs don't. And list your name there. If you don't have any other way to do it, you can just email us later and tell us you're there. Also, if you have a prayer request today, you can put that there. Remember, absolutely anything you put in the comment field is public because this is a public broadcast. So let's prepare to worship the Lord our God today.
All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. When you go, I'll go. When you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. I will follow you. Yeah. I will follow you. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone. In you alone. I will follow you, yeah. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. And if this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
Morning. We're going to pray a prayer. I put this together, I guess it was last Friday morning. I call it a prayer of deliverance. Oh God, our God, in that prayer your Son Jesus taught us to pray, we say, deliver us from evil. That is our prayer today. Deliver us from this evil called COVID-19. Deliver us from the fear that it instills. Deliver us from the insanity that it has wrought. Deliver us from this body of death. And allow us to live in your house, the house of the Lord, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come, flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Let's pray Wesley's covenant prayer. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with who you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours forever. Amen. Today, as we bring our tithes and offerings to God, I remind you at home that when we do the prayer of dedication after we sing this song, you can lift your offerings up as well and then mail them on into the church. Let's pray. Lord God, giver of every good and perfect gift, we thank you for your faithful provision for our lives. Please accept these, our tithes and offerings, as a token of our humble gratitude and eternal love. May your will always be done here on earth, just as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray.
Be my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am
Let's quiet ourselves as we go to God in prayer this morning. Oh God, it is your Spirit that enables us to walk upon the waters, but we have to have the courage to get out of the boat. Courage is something that's in short supply these days. There's so much to be afraid of, so much that we don't understand, so much that we are so unsure of. And yet we know that your Spirit is still present with us, leading us, guiding us, encouraging us to step out of the boat, not counting on anything that we understand, but counting on you. We do come today, Lord, as a people very much in need of prayer. Oh, first of all, we come lifting up Jim Foster. After being delayed, he will have his knee replacement surgery tomorrow morning. He's first up, heading into the hospital at 5:30. Also come today, Lord, praying for Bill Masterson. He was having a difficult time making his legs work, so his brother took him over to Hammett. He's up there on the 7th floor at the moment. Also come lifting up Pauline Ramos. She had an MRI. She'd had a fall a week ago, broke a couple of bones in her back. We come lifting up Kathy Plimer. She's still waiting for word on when they're going to be able to reschedule her hip replacement surgery. Can you remember Christopher over there at the Regency? We pray, Lord, he's going to continue to gain some strength. We pray for Lauren Blasky. He's having the challenges of living home alone, and I know his son's having to check in on him pretty regularly. We come today, Lord, with Mary and Reem lifting up three of her friends who are suffering from cancer. So it's Al and Bruce and Pete. Also, we come today, Lord, praying for those who are graduating. We know we've got some college graduations coming up here soon. I know Gannon's graduation will be live streamed next Saturday afternoon. We also know a number from our church who are graduating, and of course there's always these issues of the next step in life. There's always lots of things to be done when you graduate, but they're a whole lot harder to do at the moment than they normally have been. Of course, we also come praying for our community, our nation, and our world. as we continue living under this crisis that goes by the name of COVID-19. I pray today, Lord, especially for those who are ill or those who are scared. We pray for those who are laid off. We know of a few who are beginning to start to go back to work, and we're fortunate to be in a portion of the state where that's happening quicker than elsewhere. We pray especially for those in portions of the state that this isn't true. We certainly remember our brothers in the city of brotherly love, Philadelphia. We, of course, come lifting up those who are grieving loss, both loss of loved ones, loss of any sense of orientation. And we pray for wisdom and patience as we contemplate what it means to begin to slowly reopen. Also, as we do each week, we pray for some of the kids here in our neighborhood. So we pray for Joseph and Shania and for Alexis. Oh God, we're so grateful that you hear our prayers, that you are the one who gives us the courage to walk upon the waters. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Got a bunch of announcements today. First of all, I do ask if you're at home with us, worshiping with us, that you will please take that time to enter your presence there in the comment field. I said, if you don't have a comment field, you can always send us a text or an email. That'll work as well. And of course, I perpetually remind people, if you put it in the comment field, it's there forever and the whole world can see it. So don't ever say anything there you don't want to be public. We do have this new updated church directory. Every time we issue a church directory that's been updated, then people come back with all the other things we didn't know about. So anyhow, we do have copies that are available. If you're down here in town, you're free to stop by. We'll give you one. If you really need one, you call us. We'll mail it to you. We've been mailing quite a few. Yes, everybody has to wear face masks now, and going into yellow phase is only going to increase that, not decrease it. We do have a supply of face masks that a whole group of women here in our church have been so kind as to make for us. If you need one, if you stop by, we'll give you one. I know there's been a few people needing them. I've actually driven out to places to deliver them. But we want everybody to be able to have that so that we can all be safe. Let's see, worship schedule. Yes, we do go into yellow phase next Friday. For some people, yellow phase is going to mean quite a bit, because for some people it does mean that they're going to be able to resume their work. For other people, it just means, well, you're not officially told to stay in your house all the time, but you're still going to spend more time there than you want to. And relative to churches, the reality is that our bishop really doesn't want us getting together in groups of more than 25. She has interpreted what the state says as to applying to us. And so that means it's going to be a while before we can resume in-person or face-to-face worship. And nobody has any way to know what the time frame is. I've said the internal optimist in me says, okay, it's going to be another about 3 weeks. That's the fastest it could possibly go under the way it's laid out. So that means theoretically we might be able to do something on May 31st, which is Pentecost. Things that I do know, even though the guidance is very unclear, by the time you're done spacing out seating, we're not going to be able to hold near the normal number of people we might be able to. And it's still open for debate as to how it is we're going to do this, but we're going to figure it out as we go. And I've been telling you all along things to expect as that day does approach. Those people who are uncomfortable or actually at risk really are going to need to continue to stay put for some time. Nobody can tell you how long that time is, and I certainly can't tell you that. Everybody does have to wear a mask. Now, there are some exceptions. There are a few people who just can't possibly wear a mask for medical reasons. They will suffocate if they put it on. That's obviously not a good alternative. And of course, children 2 and under aren't expected to wear them. I know I could never keep a mask on Julia. That would never happen. So anyhow, that's what's going on there. There will also be, our thermometers didn't show up. That shows you how, it's a good thing we're not doing things right now. They are coming. We do have hand sanitizer stations we're going to be installing soon. We already have the seating in here spaced out. We actually can accommodate 24 people here under strict physical distancing. That amazed me. We could actually figure out how to do that. Obviously, there is no hugs or handshakes. As I said, it's been so long since the last time I shook somebody's hand, I'm not sure I can even remember how to do it anymore. We're not going to be passing things like offering plates. We could have some creative ideas how we'll deal with friendship pads, but all of that will come when that day arrives. We are continuing to keep tabs on our people. I say we do have 20 volunteers. I checked it out. They're keeping tabs on 186 people, so more than you might realize. We're very thankful for the reports that I get back from each of them as they talk to their people each week, particularly if there's any special needs. And I do remind you, we do have people who are willing to help with getting groceries or medicines or to doctor's appointments, and some of us have been doing a fair amount of that. All of our meetings have been in Zoom. It's gone better than I think we ever imagined, mostly because Melody's been willing to take time to help people figure it out ahead of time. And I know this morning, if we go ahead by one more, we will, for the third week, have our children in youth Sunday school via Zoom. That's at 10:30. They've sent links out to parents or to the kids if they have emails. And Gwen Pierce and Bob Rogers have been facilitating that. And so far, so good. It's an interesting experience. I know last week there were 10 screens, but there were 24 people. And I think Sam even was on in her car as she was driving back to Union City. I was impressed that it actually worked that well. Okay, yeah, no, but considering, you know, that was via phone that actually worked. So yes, Zoom does work on smartphones. It also works on any type of computer. The one thing with Zoom, though, is you do, you know, if they have the full experience, you do have to have a camera on your computer and a microphone. Computers about 5 years old or older didn't tend to have those. Newer ones mostly do. City Youth, I have been in touch with as many of them as I can via Facebook. It's always an adventure. We have sent an invitation out and are going to try to gather this Tuesday at 3:30 via Zoom. I have no idea how many it will be. It will probably be like a free-for-all. I've heard back from all kinds that are all excited. I said, the only thing is we haven't figured out how to go roller skating by Zoom yet. So I'm not exactly sure what we're going to do, but we're going to do something. That's right. I didn't update this. All right. The slide didn't make it because I didn't put it in there. Okay, first we'll go ahead and we'll cover this. Joe and Ann Bolash are going to have their 54th wedding anniversary. That's this coming Thursday. All right, we don't really have our normal bulletin, so we don't have any way to put that out there. So I want to let you all know that. Now they're probably watching, so you know at the moment they have to put their fingers in their ears, okay? But anyhow, if the rest of you, if you would like send congratulations to them, I'm sure they would appreciate that. All right, I went to all this trouble to make a slide last night, and unfortunately, when I made the slide, I didn't actually remember to install it this morning. But yesterday, our mayor, Joe Slemmer, announced that we are going to participate in Bells Across Pennsylvania. Now, Bells Across Pennsylvania will happen tonight at 7:00. The purpose is to honor essential workers. And the goal, he has it all laid out, the goal is to ring bells for 3 minutes. Now, this is going to be happening all across Pennsylvania. So individuals, if you have a bell, you go out on your porch or whatever and ring your bell starting at 7:00 for 3 minutes. He also asked that church bells be rung for 3 minutes. We have a beautiful bell tower over there. And we do have bats in our belfry. There has never been a real bell in that bell tower. I've been in it. I'm not even sure it was designed for one. There was an electronic carillon in there at one point, but it hasn't worked in anybody's memory. Now, so we don't have a bell in our bell tower to ring. But we own, I don't know how many octaves of bells. So we're going to be taking bells, putting them on tables over by the bronze entrance on 7th Street. And the way this works is, if you want to do this, you show up at 6:45, park in one of the church's parking lots. Remember, face masks are required. You must put your face mask on before you get out of your car. You walk over, keeping distance, okay, over by the bronze doors, And by the way, you can greet people, but remember, you know, no handshakes, no hugs, just say hello. And you can talk from 6 feet away. We do it all the time nowadays. You're not going to be able to come into the church building. We won't have restrooms available. You approach the table. There'll be some hand sanitizer things there. You clean your hands off. Take a bell. If you have little kids with you, we have some little chimes too. All right, we're going to have X's on the sidewalks, both on 7th Street, on around the bend, over onto Sassafras Street. You then take your bell, go to one of the X's. You can stand there as a household or family group, or you can stand as individuals. I'm going to be over there on the corner, across the street. So there at the corner of 7th and Sass. I'll do a countdown as we get to 7 o'clock. You then have to ring your bells for 3 minutes. By the way, you will not know how long 3 minutes is until you try to ring a bell for 3 minutes. And then as we're getting, and I'm going to video it all, and then towards the end, I'll actually do one of these kinds of things to get everybody to stop. You can then return your bell back to the table. There'll be some Clorox wipes there. You wipe your bell off, set it back on the table, go back to your car. You have to wait until you get in your car to take your mask off, and then you can drive home, and we'll post the video on our Facebook page. So if that's something you want to help with, we can maybe about 30 bell stations, we're going to spread them about 10 feet apart. And so if that's something you would like to do, by the way, if you're afraid, don't come, all right? But if it's something you'd like to do and you're willing to observe all of those rules, please come this evening. Okay. I know Harrison's here with me. And I also know we're going to get some people on the phone here in a second. Assuming I can find them here. See if we get anybody here. Well, it says calling, but I hear nothing. That's always spooky. Oh, yeah, it is ringing. Hello?
Hello?
Hey, Bob. Pastor Jim, how are you guys?
Good. How are you?
Okay, so is Bert there? Because he answered the phone when I called earlier.
Yeah.
Hi, Bert. How are you? Wow, that's loud. Okay, is Valerie there? Hey, that's Clara. How are you, Clara? Okay, what's James doing? He's screaming. That's what I heard in the background. Okay. By the way, Harrison is here. Everybody say hi to Harrison.
Hi, Harrison.
There we go. Say hi. Okay, he said hi and waved back. All right, if we go ahead by one, please. Okay, I have some. Okay, you know what true or false questions are, right? You think you can handle any of those? All right, so this is our first true or false question. We're going to let, okay, this first one we're going to let Harrison answer, okay? All right, Harrison, so here's our first question. Go ahead by one. Is today Wednesday? True or false?
True.
It's true? It's Wednesday?
No.
What do you think, Val? Do you think it's Wednesday?
I think that's false.
Okay, it's false. We tried. He's just fooling with us. He's fooling with us. Okay, the other one. Okay, this one is for Bert. Bert, are you there?
Yes.
Okay, so the question is, are we in the middle of a global pandemic? True or false? He needs
false.
Help. False. I love how we're batting none for none here. Okay. So it's true. All right. Now, we're going to up the ante, make this a little bit harder. So now what we're going to do, instead of just simple true or false questions, what we're going to do is we're going to ask or put a situation together and say, what should you do? Should you take the easy way out or should you actually do the harder thing and do the right thing? So we go ahead by one. Our first situation is there's some gummy bears and a candy dish on the counter. You go and you're hungry, so you eat one, you eat another. Finally, you ate them all. Okay? Your mom comes along. Where'd all the gummy bears go? Okay? And your dad, not really knowing, says, I don't know. I think your sister ate them. Now, would you rather just let the blame go to your sister? Or would you do the right thing and say, nah, mom, I ate them? Which would you do?
Tell the truth.
Tell the truth, yay! He gets this one. We don't care about the true and false stuff. He got the important one right. Okay, now this one, next one. Okay, Val, this is for you. Okay, you're playing a game of checkers. Have you ever played checkers?
Yes.
Okay, you're playing checkers with one of your friends. It's not going to where you're losing. And they get distracted and turn their head the other way, and you realize, if I just move my one little piece from here to there, I'll be in a perfect position to win. Okay, so you could just move your piece, or you could not. Which would you do?
I would not.
She wouldn't. She gets it right, too. She knows that she should do the right thing and not cheat. So this is a verse today, and there are a few people here, so everyone got to say this really loud because the ceiling mic will pick you up. All right, so let's read this out loud together. Anyone who knows the right thing to do and fails to do it commits sin. All right, so when you know what you should do, you need to do it. Do the right thing even when it hurts. All right, let's say a prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for giving us a conscience, the ability to know what's right and what's wrong. Help us to follow that conscience and always do the right thing. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, all of you Rogers people, okay, everybody all at once, everybody's listening at home, all of you have to say hi at once.
Okay, let me get Claire and James.
Okay, you're getting Claire and James, go ahead.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Wait, we're saying hi first and then we're gonna say goodbye.
Bye.
Okay, they're ahead of myself. Okay, everybody say bye.
Bye.
Bye. Okay, thank you, bye-bye. Harrison, you can sit down. Okay. Our Bible lesson today is again from 1 Peter, so this will be our second week there. I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 19 through 25. Of course, the words are up on the screen, and I invite you all to listen to God's word. For it is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. When you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's bow in prayer. Lord God Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth, speak to us today so that we may know the way that we should go. Lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Amen. We all live life from one day into the next. And as we pass through life, we have decisions to make. We reach that proverbial fork in the road, and the question we all face is, which path should I take? Those are moments full of apprehension. How should we choose? If we choose wrongly, will there be a way to take our choice back? Or will we be doomed to go through life forever filled with regret? Decisions, decisions, our life is full of decisions. Okay, anybody here or anybody at home, did you ever read Robert Frost's classic poem, The Road Not Taken? You know, maybe like me, you know, you read it in your high school English class. It's a very masterful, thought-provoking poem. But the interpretations of Frost's poem, they're just as varied as the people who read it. I want to open today, this is with a reading of Frost's poem, The Road Not Taken. Let's listen.
Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though, as for that, the passing there had really worn them about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet, knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
So many people, after reading Frost's poem, they've concluded that a man should go boldly, forth boldly, and chart his own course, and move ahead on a path that few have trod. So it's be a nonconformist. In love, life, live life your own way. But if that's what this poem meant, Frost wouldn't have titled his poem, he would have titled his poem, The Road Less Taken, rather than The Road Not Taken. Now others will read Frost's poem, and they'll see a man full of apprehension and regret. The man fears he will choose the wrong path, and he'll end up regretting his choice. So he stands petrified at the fork in the road, forever wondering what it might have been like to have traveled that road not taken. What we really need is we need a road map, a guide to show us if one pathway is the better than the other, or perhaps there's no difference, and just over the horizon they both lead to the same place. Like the Ethiopian eunuch, we say, how can I know the way unless someone shows me? Which path should I take? God never promised that life would be easy. Following Jesus is costly. You have to die to yourself before you can become alive in Christ. Dying to yourself isn't easy. There's pain. But what God promises is that life will be worthwhile. Whatever you have to suffer, whatever it is you have to endure, it will pale in the light of God's coming kingdom. God will make your path straight. That's another one of those nuggets of wisdom from Israel's ancient sages. It's in Proverbs 3:6 we read, in all your ways acknowledge God, and God will make your path straight. Now, Eugene Peterson paraphrases that verse like this. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on track. It was just last week I asked you the question, who would you be willing to die for? Would you be willing to die for family members and close friends? I then told you that Jesus would be willing to die for people you probably wouldn't. Jesus willingly died for sinners. This week, what I want to do is I want to shift the focus of the question from who to what. What would you be willing to die for? Would you be willing to die for your faith? Would you be willing to die for the cause of Christ? Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he was a German Lutheran pastor who the Nazis hanged just weeks before the end of World War II. Some people call him a martyr. I just know that he died because he actively resisted the Nazi persecution and extermination of the Jews. You see, as a German, Bonhoeffer accepted responsibility for what his countrymen were doing to the Jews. He wasn't one to sit idly by, so in 1943, he helped plan an assassination attempt against Adolf Hitler. Bonhoeffer's role landed him in prison, and a year and a half later, on April 8, 1945, he was condemned to death at a trial without witnesses and without the opportunity to present a defense. And at the next morning, the Nazis hanged Bonhoeffer just 2 weeks before the Americans liberated the camp that had held Bonhoeffer. Years passed, and the story of Dietrich Bonhoeffer slowly began to emerge. Today, Bonhoeffer is known best for his book, The Cost of Discipleship, which he wrote in 1937, before World War II began. In his book, Bonhoeffer writes of what he calls cheap grace and costly grace. The most quoted sentences from his book are, "Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus Christ. Cheap grace is actually no grace at all. After all, Jesus paid the ultimate price to make grace available to us all. There is nothing cheap about grace. As for costly grace," Bonhoeffer wrote, "costly grace confronts us as a gracious call to follow Jesus. It comes as a word of forgiveness to the broken spirit and the contrite heart. It is costly because it compels a man to submit to the yoke of Christ and follow him. It is a grace because Jesus says, 'My yoke is easy and my burden is light.' To follow Christ is costly. For some, like Bonhoeffer, it even cost them their lives. There really isn't anything cheap about grace. But the life of faith is still worthwhile. Bonhoeffer's life was worthwhile. Yes, God never promised that life would be easy. But God would, God will enable you to endure. Nothing can possibly ever come your way that God hasn't seen before. People may speak evil against you. They spoke all sorts of evil against Jesus. They accused Jesus of being demon-possessed. People may insult you and slander your name. Well, they insulted and slandered Jesus. People may falsely accuse you. They falsely accused Jesus, too. Whatever injustice befalls you, God will give you the strength to endure." Our Bible lesson today has Peter telling us that it is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. Resisting evil and doing good is what God has put each of us here to do. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was conscious of God, and he knew that the Holocaust was evil and therefore needed to be resisted. There are things that are worth suffering for, even dying for. Now, I'm aware that all of this isn't a particular popular topic to preach about here in the 21st century. You know, the reality is most of us here in America have fully bought into the American dream. The motto of our lives is the opening line of the second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, I know this might upset you, but the objective of life isn't the pursuit of happiness. It's the pursuit of holiness. God doesn't say, be happy because I'm happy. God says, be holy because I'm holy. Holiness can't stand evil. Holiness can't stand injustice. Holiness can't stand oppression. And when you stand up against evil, injustice, and oppression, you might just end up enduring some insults, some persecution, some pain. It all comes with the territory. That's the example we have in Jesus' life. This is what Jesus spoke about in his famous Sermon on the Mount. It's at the end of the Beatitudes. There it is, postlude, that Jesus addresses the reality of suffering. So this is Matthew 5, verses 11 and 12. There Jesus says, blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you. There is a cost to discipleship. The early Christians knew this firsthand. There is a cost for standing up for what is holy and just and right. And the price is suffering. Now, I don't think we in America have a clue what our brothers and sisters elsewhere in the world endure on a daily basis for being true to their faith. Few others enjoy the religious freedoms we do. So whatever minor inconveniences we face for being true to our faith are trivial in comparison. But as the Apostle Paul says in his letters to the believers in Corinth, for this light momentary affliction is preparing for us the eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Paul endured shipwreck, beatings, and imprisonment, all for Christ's sake. In comparison, we have endured so little. But God does and will enable each of us to endure. So take the path less traveled, the way of Christ. That is what it means to be a Christian. That's what it means to be a follower of Jesus the Christ. You do the things that Jesus did. You feed the hungry, you clothe the naked, you shelter strangers, you visit prisoners. You think the thoughts that Jesus thought. You think about whatever is true and noble and right and pure and lovely and admirable. And you endure whatever Jesus endured. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you falsely, say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Those are the ways of Christ. That's the path less traveled. Our Bible lesson today from 1 Peter in the second chapter is one of just a handful of places in the New Testament that quote the great prophet Isaiah's suffering servant passage. The servant knew the way of suffering. As Peter quotes, this is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. Jesus' way was the way of the suffering servant. He endured all things, even death on a cross, so that we might have life and have it to the full. When we share the Lord's Supper, I always use that threefold invitation that John Wesley used. I ask, do you earnestly repent of your sins? Do you have love for God and your neighbor in your hearts? And do you desire to walk in the ways of Christ? And if you do all of those things, you're welcome at the Lord's table. That's an invitation that includes all of Christ's followers. It's an invitation that includes all of us. This is Don Winstead. Don is from Donna and Mai's home church, Grace United Methodist Church in Indiana, Pennsylvania. Now, Don and her husband, Ray, love to sing in the choir. In fact, Don and Ray first met while singing in the choir many, 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 many years ago. So many it reminds me how old I am. Okay, that's Don in the picture, but I can't see Ray in that particular picture. Anyway, Don has an absolutely beautiful voice. He is a very frequent soloist. She even once recorded a CD called Blessings, and it includes an Easter classic, Via Dolorosa, which is Latin for the way of suffering. Jesus endured suffering to bring us to the Father. Are we willing to endure suffering to bring others to the Father too? Here's Don singing the chorus of Via Dolorosa.
Down the Via Dolorosa, how the way.
Jesus walked the road of suffering, and he walked it out of love for you and me. He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the sons and daughters of God. The Via Dolorosa is the path less traveled. So take the path less traveled, the way of Christ. Some are nonconformists, boldly moving ahead in life, charting their own course. While others are petrified that they might choose the wrong path and ending up with a life full of regrets. Yes, God never promised that life would be easy. Following Jesus is costly. You have to die to yourself to become alive to Christ. But God does and will enable each of us to endure. Whatever injustice befalls you, God will give you the strength to endure. So take the path less traveled, the way of Christ. Do you desire to walk in the Via Dolorosa, the way of suffering, the way of Christ? If you do, when you come to the last day, you'll be able to say the closing line of Robert Frost's poem, The Road Not Taken, and mean it. I took the path less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Let's pray. Almighty God, you have showed us the way. Now give us the strength and the courage to follow Jesus in that way, the way that leads to life eternal.
I'm going through a life afraid, maybe you're making the wrong choices. Is there even the slightest chance that you might reach the end of life and be full of regrets? Then you need to start following in the way of Jesus today. Go forth following Christ on the path less traveled. God's people said,
You are Lord of lords, you are King of kings, you are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel, you're the great I am, you're the Prince of Peace, you is Amen. You're the living God, you're our sacred space, living forever, you're eternity, you are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and Friend, you're my Prince of Peace.